Mr. Brian Iles, thank you very much.
The Bristol L is an L of a mystery. It's our strange habit of adding L to words with a vowel on the end. Linguists can't explain why. The local media get it wrong. Local comics make fun of it. And local people deride it. So this is a local yokel's search for facts. So here's a rough summary of the talk. The Bristol L is added to words where it's not spelt. So we must know about the wide range of its pronunciation in words where it is spelt. This will explain, for example, dropping the L, which a lot of people get confused about. And then as we go along, I'll ask for examples, please. I'll tell you why I'm obsessive about the Bristol L, yet tried to get rid of my own. I even ask whether it could be a deformity. A deformity of the sort of vocal apparatus. I'll tell you what we do know on where, when, why, and how. And I'll introduce a local historian to you who made a very important discovery. Then I'm going to give you the word which gives away all L users. Lots of people say, oh, I've never said the L. You have, if you're local and have got any working class background in you. I'll quote a great writer on the present status of Bristol L. And now I just want to tell you a few technical words I need to use. I've sort of been chatting with linguists over the years, but I'm only a crass amateur. But these are the words I'll be using as I go through so that you understand more what I'm talking about. Intrusive means adding a letter where it's not spelled. So area, a lot of people put L on the end. L is intrusive. Terminal is when the intrusive letter is on the end of the word, like in aerial. Linking is the other kind of intrusive letter, and that is when L or R is intruded between vowels, such as drawing. Sandy. Now, sandy is spelled S-A-N-D-H-I, and it's the linguistic term for that type of linking L or R in between vowels. And this is one of the mnemonics, one of the things you remember after. Sandy shawl is a good example of a linking L. Clear, that's another word I'll use. That means a letter when it's very distinctly pronounced. Dark L, that's when the L is very indistinctly pronounced. And at its darkest, it's the dropped L. For example, bell or mill. It's spelt bell, B-E-L-L, but it's often pronounced bell, with the L sound almost completely dropped. And the last word I'm using is schwa. It's a nice little word, I don't know what that language it is. It's S-C-H-W-A. And it means the most indistinct of all the vowels. The uh sound at the end of area. The uh sound at the end of area, it always attracts an L for people that are that way inclined. So let the entertainment begin, Roy. Campaign song from the 90s, and it's a good place to start talking about how we talk. Another word like ball is what the comic take was on how we say Corsnall Hall. So can anybody call that out for me?
Corsnall.
That's right. It's only a spoof, but it ain't far from the truth. Well spoken locals might not say Corsnall or Goodball, but lots of people do. Before we can grapple with the mystery of the L, being sounded where it's not spelled, that's the Bristol L, we have to be aware of the range of sounds people make when it is spelled. Corsnall and Blue Ball are vernacular words where L's are dropped. So are mainstream words like bell and mill. As I said earlier, we say bell and mill, or some of us do. Apart from one or two accents like the Irish, the L is often dropped in such words. Irish have a very clear L, they say bell. Farther along the spectrum, there are words like milk and talk, where a consonant, as opposed to a vowel, follows the L. Here the L may be sounded a bit. Now at the other extremity, the L is clear, the E. This happens when a vowel follows the L sound at the beginning of a word like long or London. It also happens between vowels in words such as relic and billet, or when a word like bell is followed immediately by a vowel. Now, the most well-spoken people drop the L words, drop the L in words like pork. However well-spoken you are, however posh you are, you can't help but say, you don't say pork, you say talk, or something like that. But especially at the end of words, such as middle, L dropping is more a working class habit. Now back to the song, to see the L dropped, then restored, then dropped again. Those are two lines from that chorus we heard. Bring back the ball, and the old blue ball is deep in our soul. And what I'm illustrating here is that, where am I? What I'm illustrating here is that bring back the ball shows the L being dropped from the end of the word, and the old blue ball is deep in our soul shows the L being reintroduced between ball and is. That's the way the L works. In the second example, it's linking between two vowels and it's sounded very clearly. Then it's dropped again after saw at the end there. Saw meaning saw, so. It's the way that some locals say the word so. Remember, all this so far is spelt L pronunciation, not the Bristol L, which is added intrusively. Now, it's this perversity of the L sound in normal speech, now you drop it, now you don't, which can confuse people when they think about Bristol L. So now I'll define it and talk about it a bit. Linguistically, the Bristol L is an intrusive sound. That is, it's added on, pronounced where not spelt. If it's on the end of a word, aerial, area, it's known as terminal. If it's between two vowels, like drawing, it's called linking. And linking seems to help pronunciation. The Bristol L is so called because it originated here. And much more intriguingly, for me anyway, it stayed here. Whereas the most famous intrusive letter of all, the London R, idea or idea is, has spread so far that it's now received pronunciation spoken by broadcasters and all well-spoken people around the country. Now, the extreme localization of the Bristol L is in such stark contrast to the London R's widespread. This is puzzling. Both come from working class speech, so you'd expect them to carry an equal stigma for speakers concerned with dropping such speech from their vocabulary. If any of you have got computers, if you Google Labov, you'll read about famous research which illustrated how people spoke for prestige. You can read that there, but I'll read it out Labov showed that in a big store, staff on the fashion floor spoke posher than those in the bargain basement. It makes sense, it may seem to be stating the obvious, but this is a case where stating the obvious was proved to be the case by a lot of research. But there's been no research to question why the L stayed in its Bristol ghetto, even though linguists agree that it is a mystery. As I've said, the L is not only local, and it's even patchy within its localities. You hear it in parts of Kingsford, parts of Hannam, but not everywhere. But it is also limited to people of working class origin, who still speak it in some districts in the city, plus the suburbs of Hannam and Kingswood. Could I have a few examples of the Bristol L, please? Can you think of any?
Miracle.
Yeah, Bristol. A miracle. Yes, a miracle.
It's a miracle.
It's a miracle. It's a miracle, yeah. And that was Dorian Lindegaard, who you'll be seeing later. Asdil, that's another one that Elaine has given me. Yeah, that's a pretty common one. Now, both of these, it's interesting, are terminal L's. In other words, they're on the end of a word. And so, quite often, the L can't be heard very, very much in such words, but I think those are two where, as they're common words, you can hear the L on the end.
What about the whole of
Africa? Yeah, you saw that one in the Evening Post a while back, did you?
Years ago.
Oh, that's Roger, yeah, that's right, yes. That's a famous one, isn't it? That's a brilliant one, that. Yeah, that is alliteration gone mad. Right. Here's another example from somebody you all know.
The Bristol City motto is Virtute et Industria, which I suppose really means we work hard and we're virtuous in the bargain. Of course, we natives do pronounce it Virtute et Industria. Here's a song about it.
Oh, we be Bristol kids, we come from Bristol City, where all the folks is handsome and all the birds is pretty. We're proud of our own town, it never gets we down, and we got a little motto, always sings up Mr. Down. Oh, Virtue et Industria, three cheers for Novers Hill. If the city don't win Saturday, perhaps the Rovers will. Virtue et Industria, shout it to the neighbour. Virtue et Industria, it's city down to labour.
You cut all thread off a bit sharp there. This is Fred Wedlock's take on our city's Latin motto. The weak vowel on the end of a word, we call it schwa, is the most common sound where L is added. This is what's so odd, because as we've seen, with similar end sounds, L can also be dropped. Both and O, plus some other sounds, work in this way. So Fred, he adds an intrusive L to the Latin word industria, but he might very well drop the end L of industrial and say industria. Another thing to point out at this juncture is that the Bristol L is more likely to occur where there's a similar word spelt with an L on the end. For example, that word, that is a Latin word, it's true, but industria sounds very much like industrial, which is a word we often use, and when that's the case, words which are spelt with an L on the end, they give you the chance to intrude a Bristol L. Here are a few more Bristol L's to show how varied they can be in this confusing mishmash of L pronunciation. This is a brilliant one to start with because it's from a linguist at the Centre for Linguistics up at the UWE. You can't get reception in this area. Now this professor up at the university, he actually overheard a TV engineer say that with an aerial at this time. It's brilliant, you couldn't think of anything better. My next one is from an old relative of mine. He was about 70 at the time. He said, somebody smashed my window. And then another relative of mine, I'm not giving their names, so I shan't be showing them up if this gets onto YouTube. He said he found a dead sparrow lark. And then an MA I know, he's about 60 at the time. I give the ages to indicate the sort of people, the sort of age people are when they're still talking the owl. An MA I know sometimes says, I gotta have a drink. And then another linguist said, I like drawing. Now I'm going to ask my friend Des to give his example.
No, it's just a friend of mine, he went to a nightclub, he got chatting to some young women. I don't know how the conversation got round to this, but one of the women said, I haven't got me brawl on, mind.
Thanks, Brett.
That one has the virtue of being very funny, but the best example I know of a Bristol L following an unfamiliar ending. As I said earlier, the sound is the usual one which persuades people to say to put an L on, but bra long, that was a new one on me when Des told it, and I haven't heard a similar one since, not with a. I heard a little boy in Cajun a couple of years ago say, our Merle ain't coming. That was a good one. And then, not so long ago, an old lady in Hammond said, yell I will. Actually put an L after the S, which I found remarkable. There's such a lot of variety, it's all very complicated. You just can't be simplistic about Bristol L, which is what a lot of people have been over the years. I shall slip one in every now and then, sort of quite unconsciously, because that's what people do. No. But why do I go so far as to say it's a mystery? Well, I want to capture attention, first of all, but I really do think it is a mystery. And if the Centre for Linguistics on our very own doorstep at UWE, the University of West of England, plus a couple of professors in print, can say why the Bristol L has always been in Bristol, it's got to be a mystery, as my MA friend would say. When I was posted to the Air Ministry Worcester at the age of 17 in 1951, I was teased rotten for my Bristol L. My workmates from all over the country had all sorts of accents, but none of them had a quirk like mine. By the time I went to London in 1959, I thought I'd gotten rid of my Bristol L. We're still in the social desk. I soon found that quite a few locals were still using the intrusive L's, but it was only after I retired that I had time to look for answers. So I thought it was a godsend when the Centre for Linguistics opened on my very doorstep at UWE in 2008. It so happened that I just got the derivation of Hannum confirmed from a place name expert at the centre. Anyway, he kindly invited me to the inaugural lecture of the centre, but it was a start that sadly didn't go very far. My contact referred me to written material, but there are few books which say anything about Bristol L, and these for no more than a few pages without even exploring the underlying mystery. The list of examples not featured in the literature is endless. Here's just a couple more that I find particularly good. A chap on the allotment asked his friend, dug any potatoes yet? And have you got a wheelbarrow? Now these examples are all personal anecdotes from the here and now. They don't say anything about survival statistics. Linguistic literature, however, has plenty of stuff about speech habits, dialects, and languages dying out. On the fate of the Bristol L, I would like to misquote Mark Twain. Reports of its death have been greatly exaggerated. It's alive and well, as far as I know. While my contact at the centre emphasises the difficulty finding historical evidence, he's still been helpful in answering the question of when the entrance of hell might have originated. Now, the first thing to say here is that the earliest documentary evidence, that's stuff written down, is hidden in the mists of medieval time when language is changing from French to English in the 13th century. By the 16th century, there were printed documents in English in Bristol showing a new spelling of our city's name with an L on the end for the first time. The Blue Ball song speaks of the old Bristol L going back as far as the pub. That's 300 years or so. So Bristol imprint must surely be proof of this. If you see Bristol written down, that must prove that that was when it was being spoken, with an L on the end. I certainly thought that was the case, but my linguistic friend said it wasn't that simple. There was in fact evidence from 300 years earlier, that is the 1300s, that Bristol could have been derived from another source. The Latin word for Bristol at that time was Bristolia, and when that became anglicised, it suggested that the ear was dropped off to produce the word Bristol back in the 13th century. Of course, this evidence doesn't rule out the Bristol plus L explanation, but it just means there are two explanations and we're not sure which is or if both occurred at separate times. Until recently, the earliest time that linguists could be sure of was no earlier than the 19th century. And then the Bristol Records Office came up with a document which pushed that date back to 1871. Now, can everybody read that? So you can see you can see the way that name was spelled, Lavinio. Now the only reason it could have been spelled that way was because that was the way the lady told the scribe. That was the way that she pronounced it. So that is what linguists regard as evidence that a certain way of speaking was ongoing at that time. So that is documentary proof that the Bristol L was available, what was going on in 1871. But there was better to come. Some real citizens outside the cities. I'd written an article in Kingswood Grammar School's Old Scholars magazine pleading for evidence of Bristol L. Response was disappointing until an old scholar came up with a nugget. And so I'm now going to introduce Doreen Lindegaard briefly. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The small part of the workhouse story concerns the court appearance of a young lady, and you heard Brian say about spelling phonetically, of which Lavinio and so on is an idea. Anyway, and no doubt that this particular young lady spoke herself in this way, using, although she was in Cajun, the notorious Bristol L. And she called herself, or she spoke in this way, and a newspaper reporter picked it up and wrote about it in the paper, and he called her Marshall Wellington. And the case was reported that she was in on the 27th of September, 1862. Marshall was a workhouse child. She was baptized at the same time as her sister Harriet. These two girls were the daughters of Elizabeth Wellington, a single woman. And Marshall was not called Marshall at all. She was baptized in the name of Marcia, M-A-R-C-I-A. Once again, that's a fairly unusual name for those times. Anyway, she's still in the workhouse in 1841, when the census was taken, and now her name is something different again. She's called Marsha, without any L or without anything else, M-A-R-S-H-A. Anyway, she turns up once again in 1865, also again before the beak, and it gives some idea of how she actually spoke herself, because she was charged with leaving
her two illegitimate children at Kinchin Workhouse and going off and working somewhere elsewhere. And they have her down there once again as Marshall Wellington.
So that's some real documentary evidence on the when question, even though it would be great if the much older possibilities proved to be true. We've also got a very good idea where the Bristol L comes from. The places in which it still exists, of course. The working class areas of Bristol. Is that local, is that unique? There's no evidence of it being spoken anywhere else in the world. I can't emphasize this enough. It truly is a phenomenon which should be of great interest and importance to both linguists and local historians. And I'm ever so glad of this opportunity to talk about it in Hammam, because this is one of its hotbeds. Now, to emphasize the uniqueness of this Bristol L, let me remind you about the London R. This is the same sort of linguistic trick. It's the most famous example of an intrusive consonant. John Darville, Radio Bristol, showed it off brilliantly recently when he mentioned Drury. So, exemplifying the fact that people in the media and broadcasters and well-spoken people use drawing. They don't say drawing, they say drawing. In my opinion, just as ugly as drawing, but there you are. The London R is now all over the country. The Bristol L is still in Bristol. And the main reason I'm given by linguists is because of this peer pressure thing that people don't want to take it with them when they go anywhere else. The how and the why of the Bristol L are much more difficult to cope with, though. Until we get answers to these, the mystery will remain. I said earlier that the linguistic theories how the intrusive L may have come about are too technical for this sort of talk. There has been an answer offered by a layman, but it's so fanciful, it's more like a rhetorical question. Could there be some kind of deformity of the speech apparatus confined solely to working class Bristolians? Now, a chap called Noam Chomsky reckons that ability to speak is partly innate. And so a local mutation that didn't spread and then died out could be a possibility. That could account for the fact that the L has never spread beyond Bristol. But it's a fanciful theory. So the last question, why, is twofold. Why have an intrusive letter anyway? And two, which is the biggie, why is the L so extremely localized? The answer to the first question, why have an intrusive letter anyway, seems to be sort of obvious. The L and the R are the only examples we need to mention here, e.g. drawling and drawing, but I understand there may be others. I think some people say that W is another intrusive letter, but I don't know about that, so I can't talk about it. Whereas the Bristol L has remained with people of working class origin and has been virtually underground a lot of the time, with the speakers often unaware of their habit, as I indicated earlier, the London R has become resoundingly official. Everybody who's anybody uses the London R. But remember, this is only as pronunciation, not spelt. The London R is not spelt any more than the Bristol L is. And now, I expect some of you think, is there a terminal L at all, because you don't hear it? Well, here's a joke. Has anybody heard the joke about the little old lady shopping for fish in the market? The stall owner tells her he's sold out of cod. But she keeps coming back with the same order. In the end, the stall owner says, "Madam, keep no suspense. Madam, We ain't got no COFD card. The literate old lady replies, there's no effing card. You may say a similar thing to me about terminal L's. There's no flipping L in a miracle. If you can't hear it, there isn't one. So I hope all this shows two things. Firstly, how tricky dark terminal L's are to pick up. Secondly, that they are there, lurking on the boundary between schwa, and dark L, but they only show when a following vowel exposes them. A miracle, after all, does have a flipping L, in my opinion. Sorry about all that, and let's hear Eddie singing a song upon Hammond Hills, as heard on YouTube.
Now I know a lot of people who do not enjoy their meals, but instead they hit the bottle to throw down their stomach pills. I used to be the same myself, I know how much it feels. But now when I don't feel so good, I go up on the mills. And the mills, and the mills make a very pretty scene. They just walk the dog or watch the birds or just admire the greenery. Don't talk to worry about the downs or even those stuff mills, cause deep is far, far better off on high on them hills.
That's my old friend Eddie. But what I really wanted to point out in Eddie's song is another quirk which seems to have spread from London besides the intrusive R and possibly the dropped L, and which it has an important bearing on what we're talking about. On the wireless back in World War II, anybody take that that far? Cockney Jack Warner used to tell us he was real ill. Remember Dixon of Dock Green? But before that, his persona was a Cockney in London. Well, perhaps it was then as well. Eddie speaks like this in the song. He eats mills for meals. He dances rills instead of reels. And this makes him feel, not feel, happy. These are called vowel shifts. They're very prevalent in working class lingo and are often followed by dropped L's. There's the meal-to-mill shift, just quoted. Then there's the bowl-to-ball shift. People don't say boo-ball, they say boo-ball. And another one, the whales-to-wells shift. Now, hands up anybody who's not really sure when somebody says to them they've just come back from Wells. There must be others than I that have been confused by that. Well, that's an example of what they call a vowel shift. People nowadays, working class people more, I suppose, they say Wells rather than Wales when they mean Wales. It's the meal to mill shift that actually bears most strongly on the Bristol L situation, though. It really picks out the sheep from the goats, the L users from the non-L users. Because if you hear someone say, I diddle, you know. People who drop L's are also the ones who add them. They're both working class habits. And I think this is the most common of all Bristol L words, where the two opposite habits meet most perfectly. So as we draw to a close, here's some nice old-fashioned singing to suit brains that may be aching like L. She was a famous singer in her day, and she lived most of her life in Bristol. And she's one of the people that she's one of the names that people use as an example of the L. As plain Miss Turner, you might not hear the dark L on Eva Turner, but when she marries Mr. Atkins, not only she, but her Bristol L blossoms. It's the linking L again. Eva Atkins. Eva Turner, you can't hear the L. Eva Atkins, you can hear it, but the ugly. So the mystery of the Bristol L poses four questions. When, where, how, and why? We know where is some inkling of when. How has never been answered properly, neither has why. Until those final questions are answered, we shall be left with the mystery of the Bristol L. Thank you. April Beckley.
The only thing I'm going to say is that I came from London, and I was very, in 1970, and I was very conscious of this accent and this L because I worked in Barton Hill. And a girl called Nina, N-I-N-A, was always called Neenel. And I thought it was fascinating, and I think the talk we've received and the research that you've done, Brian, is absolutely fascinating.
Roger?
Yep. Okay, so stand up here. I just picked up a few examples of the Bristol L. I picked up over a lifetime. I used to work with a chap who drove a Vauxhall, and the model was an Astra. It was also an Astra L. So he was very proud to say, I drive a Vauxhall Astra. I'm not sure, he might have changed it later for a Ford Fiesta.
Thank you very much for coming, and once again, Brian, thank you very much indeed for a most entertaining afternoon. Thank you.